Tonight on Fourth Down on Four, it's Dave Wilson to the rescue as the Saints come from behind in Cincinnati. The first man of the second city says goodbye. A coach from the Crescent City says goodbye. And we'll talk live with Saints sacker Pat Swilling.
Fourth Down on Four is brought to you by Superior Acura, New York Life, McDonald's, and the Louisiana Coca-Cola Bottling Company. Bottler of Diet Coke, the one-calorie cola, just for the taste of it. And now, here's Chris Myers.
Good evening, all. Welcome to our show. The Saints chase for the NFC West title and the home field advantage in the playoffs still hanging by a thread tonight. Got a break with Washington losing moments ago. They stumbled a bit today, but stood up straight enough to pull off their greatest comeback of this, their greatest season. It's a given against the Bengals, but a 21-point deficit is difficult to overcome against anybody. And the final numbers would indicate blowout. The Saints did that, but in the late stages of the game, ringing up a 41-24 total, 38 unanswered points, their eighth consecutive win, and now an 11-3 record, second only to the 49ers, who lead their NFC Western Division. Pat Swilling and Mike Jones will join us in a moment, and later a musical video for Saints believers. But first, the comeback at Riverfront.
Like a good Cub Scout, Dave Wilson was prepared. The much-maligned Saints quarterback came off the bench in the second quarter and led the Saints to 38 unanswered points. Ironically, his 9 of 15 passes for 160 yards and a touchdown came in the same city where he lost the starting job in the final preseason game this year.
Cincinnati was the spot that I lost my starting job, maybe not just in that particular game, but this is the place that the decision was made to go with Bobby. And so when you come back to a place like that, obviously that goes to your mind. And
Dave's done such a great job all season, keeping himself prepared each week, ready to go in the ball game, and he showed it today. This is an indication of the attitude that he showed all year as our backup quarterback. I mean, he went in, and there was just nothing, you know, not hardly any drop off at all.
It took an injured knee to Bobby Hebert to pick up an attack that was beating itself. A vocal Jim Mora wanted his line to toe the line and block. And when their starting quarterback went down, that did it.
He kind of in an emergency situation. It takes, you know, a lot extra from everybody. I think you will get that. People, you know, turning it up a few notches there when something like that happens.
The Saints were playing catch-up from the opening series. Cincinnati scored on their first three possessions and built a 24-3 lead, a time in the past when this Saints team might have thrown in the towel.
When I know they got that touchdown off of chip pad, I like, well, this is going to be a rough day for us. And it was kind of chill out there. Everybody had to get really loosened up, and everybody had to buckle down like, hey, man, this is going to be a rough night for us.
I felt like we were playing a little below par early, okay? And not just, not like I say, not flat, but just a little bit below par, and we picked it up a little bit.
A no-huddle, hurry-up offense and cool, breezy temperatures chilled a hot Saint defense in Cincinnati. But when Mora's Constrictors, led by Ricky Jackson, put the heat on Boomer Esiason, Bengal fans could hardly bear to watch.
They was giving us all that no-huddle stuff. We played conservative defense and didn't get out there. And after that, coaches went all out, you know, just go out the merry trips or whatever they're doing. We're going to butt them in the mouth and get to that quarterback.
Six sacks and four turnovers caged the Bengals in the second half, and the Saints pick off their eighth straight win on their run toward the postseason.
All right, maybe he should have scored. Joining us in the studio, number 56, second-year linebacker Pat Swilling. Number 86, wide receiver, leading receiver on the day, Mike Jones. Mike, first let me ask you, congratulations on a good comeback. How did things change when Dave Wilson came in and Bobby left injured?
Well, it really wasn't a big change going into halftime. We knew that we didn't execute as good as we should have in the first half. So coming out the second half, we knew that we had to get on the ball, and regardless who was quarterbacking, we had to do our job.
But does something happen when a guy gets, you see him being helped off the field? I mean, does that fire you up a little more?
Well, normally when one of your starters go down, especially quarterback, guys get a little more concerned and probably wonder if they're doing their job to the best of their abilities. And I guess it kind of shook the guys up when Bobby did go down, and we came back strong.
Pat, five tackles today, two sacks. 24 points for the Bengals in the first half, zip nada in the second half. What adjustments did you make?
Well, we didn't make many adjustments. I think the guys felt a sense of urgency to come out and play good in the second half because they've been keeping us off balance by what they were doing with running play after play, audible after line and everything. So I feel like the guys got together on defense and on offense also and just felt like that we need to go out and make a stand and show that we have a good quality football team. And I think we did that today and showed a lot of people that we can win.
Viewers saw Jim Mora hollering at the offensive line, of course, at that stage of the game. But halftime, you guys were telling me before we went on, no big deal. He wasn't doing that woulda, coulda, shoulda stuff.
No, he didn't say much. He just told us that, you know, to go out and play football the way we could, Saints football, and that's what we really did. And, you know, it paid off. We just got back to doing what we know we can do, and you know, it paid off in the end.
All right, excellent performance and greeted at the airport tonight. We'll show you that as soon as we come back as we continue here. We'll pursue the standings and also talk some more with Pat and Mike. Stay with us. The scene tonight at the airport as the Saints arrived back in town about 6:30 or 7. Hundreds of people at the airport. You saw Dave Wilson with a victory cigar, and they were out there cheering and hollering as the Saints win again. We're back live on Fourth Down on Four. Next week on our show, Jim Mora will be here to recap the year and preview the playoffs, and our show will continue each Sunday night at 10:35 for as long as the Saints last in their drive toward San Diego and Super Bowl 22. Speaking of which, the NFC playoff standings as we look right now, San Francisco, the best overall record at 12-2, and of course they play the Rams next Sunday night. Washington lost tonight, so they're 10-4, but they've won the Eastern Division. The Bears have won the Central, and look at the Saints, the leading wild card team at 11-3. The remaining teams shooting for that wild card, the Vikings hold the upper hand. The Cardinals, the Rams, who play tomorrow night, must win again against the 49ers and hope that the Vikings would lose along the way to get in. Are you guys confused by all this? I know you concern yourself with winning your game, but you must do a little scoreboard watching. Pat?
Well, we like to see who's winning every week and everything, and it kind of keeps us up on who we might be playing in the playoff. But right now, we really don't know because the race is kind of tight and everybody's playing pretty good football to try to get into the playoffs.
Mike, you were with the Vikings before the Saints. You keep in touch with anybody back there and say, hey, I don't want to see you down here.
Well, I like to catch guys answering service. Only thing I'd probably say then is, who dat?
You leave who dat on the answering
That's
service.
Right.
The AFC standings, let's just update that quickly. Indianapolis leading in the East. Miami won tonight, so they're in that playoff picture. The Jets have been eliminated. New England and Buffalo hanging on. In the Central, the Browns are the top gun there. If they win next week, they win the division. Houston and Pittsburgh still a shot. The Bengals, as we know, out of the picture. And in the West, the Broncos have clinched at least a wild card, and they're the leaders to win that division. Seattle loses again today. Wins, but San Diego loses again today, so they're falling fast. And woeful last 5 weeks for the San Diego Chargers. On your game today, let's talk about what I thought, and we're with Mike Jones and Pat Swilling, was the key, the turning point of the game, and it was late second quarter. Dave Wilson comes in, he throws, completes a pass to you, Mike, and talk about what's going on in this series.
Well, actually, it was just a crossing route, and we caught him in man coverage, and I was able to slip behind the linebacker there and get to the ball.
And this, the 29-yard touchdown, nice catch. They were blitzing here, right?
Well, probably sending more men than we thought they would. On this particular play here, we lined Mel Gray outside of me, and we figured if the safety comes out to cover him, that we knew that they were going to be in man coverage.
And you hang on to it. Pat, this is where you go in and knock that ball away next series.
Well, Ricky came from the backside and was able to knock the ball loose, and it enabled me to come. I was rushing also, coming to pick up the ball, and I tried to get a couple of yards, but they got to me.
Was there ever a sense of, I don't know if panic is the right word, but I know a lot of Saints fans, I was worried. 24-3, the Bengals looked good. You guys were not on your game. Mike, was there some hesitation there?
Well, it's sort of tough to comment because, it's just a tight situation at that time. And, who knows what can happen in these games. They're all tough, not only the games you think you should win. All of them are going to be tough. And teams are going to challenge you, so it's tough.
What have you heard on Bobby Hebert? From what we understand, he could have come back in and played if he had to. Do you expect him to go next week?
Probably so. You never know what goes on with an injury within the 24-hour period, so we have to wait and see.
Okay, Pat, you're the leading sacker on the Saints this year, 10.5 sacks, and you stressed that half when I said 10 earlier, so I guess they all add up. We're going to take a look at some of the plays you were involved in. Now, the touchdown that the Bengals got on the tip pass, you were watching that on the, and we're going to have a replay of it here. Are you just trying to knock it away here?
Well, I was trying to knock the ball down, and when I saw it, it was coming at a very low angle, so I thought I could maybe get to it and knock it down or deflect it, and we could get the ball, but it enabled them to get the ball, and, you know, it just turned out that way.
And then second quarter, first sack on Boomers. You finally beat, you had a tough day early, at least, I guess. Was that Munoz on your side?
Yeah, I had Munoz as an AFC Player of the Year last year, and he's a tough competitor and everything. On that play, I had Kennevue, the running back, and then I was able to get around on the backside and get a sack.
And this is one of those in-the-grasp rules. They did call it. From a defensive player standpoint, do you like that in-the-grasp rule? I don't like it. I think it's too judgmental where an official can really change the flow of a game.
Well, I like it because sometimes you get there and, you know, they're still standing, they're trying to throw the football, but you got them down and everything, and it gives you an opportunity to really get there and get your hands around them. Because some guys can really get away, and it's hard to get them down. But once you get your hand around them, you know, usually the official calls it and everything, and it enables you to get a sack.
Did it just come down to beating your man? It looked like in those first few series in the first quarter, the Bengals' offensive line was giving Boomer enough protection.
Well, they were throwing us off balance. We couldn't get into any real good calls from Coach Sidwell. And what really happened, we just got down, and guys decided we had to go beat our own man. And that's what we did. We went one-on-one. The guys had one-on-ones, had to win. And most of the guys had one-on-one. We won today and got some sacks.
Mike, one question before we break. Dave Wilson said in this offense, in our newscast, in this kind of offense, you can come from behind because it's kind of a wide-open attack with balance. Can you tell me a little bit more about that? The pass routes seem to be lengthy enough to pick up necessary yardage, 15, 20-yard routes.
Well, I think our running game is probably the feature of our offense. The passing game is another dimension to it, to the offensive system, and I think that the receiver corps and the quarterbacks are very good at doing what they're doing with the passing game, and as long as we continue to connect on passes and get in the end zone, I think we'll be successful.
All right, we'll continue with Mike Jones and Pat Swilling, and when we come back, scores and highlights from around the league. Stay with us. Myers back with you on Fourth Down on Four, and thanks for staying up with us. The Vikings, as we mentioned earlier, kept their hold on the NFC wildcard spot. The Broncos clinched at least a wildcard spot, even though they didn't play. Pittsburgh and San Diego lost, guaranteeing Denver that position. Now, in the NFC West, the Niners kept bouncing along and ahead of the Saints, and if Santa's going to get to the Bay in time, he's going to need to cross the desert. So that's a real camel, I want you to know. Jerry Rice didn't need a camel, an NFL record 19 touchdown receptions in a season as he hauls this one in from Steve Young against Atlanta. Also, a touchdown in 12 straight games, a record. But the Falcons got on the scoreboard. Watch as a 97-yard kickoff return from Sylvester Stamps down the left sideline all the way. It's 14-7. 49ers. But on the next kickoff, Marion Campbell thought he was back in it. Watch Joe Cribbs, only the third time in NFL history that back-to-back kickoffs have been returned for touchdowns. He goes 92 yards. Looks a little like slow motion the way he's moving there, but he went all the way, and the 49ers win easily without Montana. 35-7 was the final. Under the Silverdome roof, Mr. Excitement himself, Jerry Burns, trying to help secure a playoff spot. Now, here's a facing off of LSU performers, Gary James of the Lions, headed for the end zone. Ball knocked loose, and Henry Thomas, starting for the Vikings on the defensive line, recovers. Detroit turned the ball over, and Wade Wilson, who threw for a score, runs for this one. 17-7 Vikings lead, but Gary James hangs onto the football, this time a 15-yard touchdown. It was 17-14, Lions moving for a tying field goal, possibly a winning score, but Chuck Long intercepted for the fourth time in this game as Carl Lee hangs on and the Vikings win it 17-14. Soldier Field in Chicago truly was Peyton's place today. The Bears retiring the jersey of the game's all-time rusher. He went out with a 2-touchdown game against Seattle as he's in, but the Seahawks fighting for playoff chances answered that on what was one of the longest screen passes ever. Dave Craig slips to John L. Williams. Runners set up out in front of him. And he gets good blocking. And then a nice cutback move here to go 75 yards for a touchdown as the Seahawks had it their way in Chicago. Mike Ditka ready to throw the gum, but he kept chewing. Mike Tomczak, another rough time. He was dogged all day. Seahawks, one of the leaders in sacks in the NFL, and they bring him down 34-21 as Seattle turns it into a rout. At the Coliseum, the Raiders and Browns, and Ernest Biner from Bernie Kosar, who's getting better and better, 7-3 on a short touchdown catch. Second quarter now, it's 10-3 Cleveland. Again, it's Kosar, and again, it's Biner in to make it 17-3 Cleveland on top. Kosar, 294 yards and two touchdowns. This one goes to Webster Slaughter, and the Browns needed all of it because the Raiders got within seven, had a chance to tie, but the fumble was recovered by Cleveland. The final 24-17, Cleveland knocks off the Raiders. In other games, the Cardinals kept their wild card playoff hopes alive, winning 31-14 New England over Buffalo. It was the Eagles defeating the Jets. Joe Walton may be looking for work. Houston, with two touchdown passes from Warren Moon to Drew Hill, defeated the Steelers. It was the Colts, 115 yards for Eric Dickerson, beat those slumping Chargers. Tonight, Miami knocked off Washington 23-21, and the Monday Nighter has the Cowboys and the Rams in Anaheim. But before we let you two go, let me just ask you about Green Bay. Obviously, not a lot of time to think about that, but will that be a tough game, knowing that you're already in the playoffs, they're out of the picture, and even if you have a great record, you may still be a wild card team?
Well, I don't think it'd be tough to get up because it's our last regular season game, and everybody'd be excited for the game, and we're at home, and we love playing at home, so I don't think it'd be any way that we can be down for the game. We'll be excited and ready to go.
All right, Mike, the running game, you're going to look for that to pick up a little bit, help out that passing attack?
We need it. We're getting tired of running down the field a little bit, so we need that running game to kick in there. But I think we're going to be pretty tough this weekend. I think we're going to get drilled a little harder on working on the run.
Okay, good. It's a home seller. For being our guest, you each get compliments of Sue's Jewelry, these tie class 14-karat gold. They have the Saints emblem on that. You can wear that on your tie. And thanks for being here. Mike, good luck to you. All right, we'll see you next week. Same with you, Pat. Keep up the good work. When we come back, Mack Brown declares his independence from Tulane, and we'll salute some believers. Back live on Fourth Down on Four. College football's bowl season, 2 down, 16 to go. LSU headed for Jacksonville in the Gator Bowl with South Carolina. Of course, the Sugar Bowl teams, Auburn and Syracuse, will be rolling in around Christmas. Last night in Shreveport, Tulane took it on the chin, falling to Washington at the Independence Bowl. Mack Brown leaves after 3 years, never finishing above 500. Joe Amato reports.
The Independence Bowl was a week-ending thud for Tulane. The usually well-oiled, mechanized Green Wave offense never got out of park. Ever the perfectionist, quarterback Jones blamed himself.
I wasn't hitting my receivers, and they were open, and I just wasn't putting it on.
We couldn't be consistent, and I think that happened some with an option offense in a bowl game. We had finals in between there, and a little rain after we got up here for practice.
Tulane's defense held the Washington Huskies to just 3 points in the second half. Wave defender James McKinley picked off two Chris Chandler passes.
Yes, I think we played very good defense, you know, because we were challenged, you know, by a bigger ball club.
But Tulane's only touchdown came on this punt return by Mitchell Price. He's had a big play year.
He's still on his feet. He can go all the way. Here goes Price. He's gone. And it'll be 7-6.
Otherwise, Tulane students at the game had to resort to savage jeers and taunts of Coach Mack Brown. But in taking the Wave to their first bowl game in years, the departing Brown may have planted a seed.
We learned we need to go to another bowl because it is real fun. We need to win into it to keep the enjoyment going.
And this is about what I told them in there. You learned in this one what going to a bowl's like. The next step is going and winning.
And Tulane's new coach is with us now, Greg Davis. Greg, congratulations. And any word on the staff yet?
Joe, thank you very much. I'm extremely excited. It kind of all hit me this morning when I woke up, but no, we have no announcement right now. Mack and I have visited. We visited with members of the staff, but anytime you talk about coaches changing jobs, there's a lot of things to be considered. There's families to be considered, and there's things like that. It's not an easy thing to do to just up and move. But I think very quickly we'll have some kind of announcement on the staff.
Anytime a new coach comes in, there's concern about a change in the offense or defense. You're still going to throw, right?
Every coach in America does what their players do best, both offensively and defensively. The thing we're going to do is we're going to emphasize the talents that we have. With Terrence Jones, we're going to continue to throw the drop back pass and run the option, and we're going to continue to recruit players that fit that style of offense.
Coach, I was hoping you'd say that. And for all of us at Channel 4 and, of course, all the Tulane fans, wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much, Joe.
Okay, Chris, there you go.
All right, thanks, Joe, and happy holidays to you and yours. All right, time now for our Diet Coke ticket giveaway. This week's winner, Donnie Vella of Destrehan. Congratulations, you'll get to go to the Saints-Packers game. Now, anyone can win. Just send your name and address on a postcard, and next week's Sugar Bowl tickets go out. Diet Coke ticket giveaway, 1024 North Rampart Street, New Orleans, 70116, and good luck. Hope we draw your name. Next week, the Saints are home at noon against Green Bay. Game is sold out. You'll see it here live on Channel 4. Saints playoff tickets go on sale a week from tomorrow at 8 a.m., about 23,000 available, and you better get in line if you want them. Thanks to Pat Swilling and Mike Jones for being with us. Next week, Jim Mora will be here, and I hope you will too. For a while today, the Saints' winning streak was in doubt, but as they have shown their diehard fans, winning is believing, and Saints fans are believing.
Was brought to you by Superior Acura, New York Life, McDonald's, and the Louisiana Coca-Cola Bottling Company, bottler of Diet Coke, the one-calorie cola, just for the taste of it.